We are live, sir.
Hi, morning friends. Welcome to our IES webinar number 11. And this is a very, very interesting webinar. It's a webinar which is much different from previous webinars because it's dealing with a case discussion session and is led by and moderated by none other than Dr. Sanjay Desai, the pioneer in shoulder arthroscopy in the country. And the panel is an extremely good panel here. We have Dr. Shashank Mishra from Delhi in the panel, Dr. Nilesh Kamath from Pune in the panel, Dr. Sanjay Garude from Mumbai, and Dr. Parag Shah from Gujarat in this panel. So this panel is going to discuss about a young, painful shoulder. And I think Dr. Sanjay is going to grill the faculty and go through the nuances of cases, which he's going to talk about the painful shoulder in young people. Dr. Sanjay Desai, all yours, sir.
Thank you very much, IPS, and thank you, Indian Arthroscopy Society, and a special thanks to all the expert panelists. We have a very learned panelist here, and as is our normal routine, I think most of us are familiar with the case discussion routine. So I have a collection of good 6 or 7 cases, and we will try to extract as much knowledge as possible. That's my job, from all these experts over here. And all this is for the benefit of the audience. So thank you very much, IAS, once again, and to Samantha and IPS. So here is, my screen is visible to all.
Yeah, it's visible.
Yes. Okay.
Sir, meanwhile, the questions will start coming from the delegates as well. And once you finish your case, we'll start asking some questions in between as well.
Okay. So once I show the case, as we do it in our physical conferences.
Absolutely, sir. The way you want it to run, you can run. And by end of the case, if there are some burning questions, we will ask the panel as well as you.
Okay. You mean from the audience? Okay.
From the audience. Yeah. Because they are going to write on chats.
Fair enough. So we have a... Now, this first case, there is a possibility that one or two panelists might be familiar with the case. Paraksha, if I think, might be knowing. In case you know, please be generous enough to volunteer and not reveal the case, please.
Will do, sir.
So first is a 52-year-old Arab male. It's a very interesting story. This is somewhere in the late 1990s, and I was... going around with my bags full of arthroscopy equipment, and one orthopedic surgeon in Mumbai called me saying, Sanjay, I have a frozen shoulder and I want you to come and do an arthroscopic release in this hospital. So I said, of course, kuch kaam to tha nahi waise, to main apne bag leke, I went to do this shoulder arthroscopy, and I saw that he is an Arab male. There was a little difficulty in communicating with him. He didn't know Hindi or English. But he did manage to tell that he had a fall 4 years ago. And when I examined him, he had pain and stiffness. His forward elevation was about 130. Internal rotation was to L1, but the external rotation was grossly restricted, was minus 10 degrees. So it was, he was having an internal rotation deformity. So now this is the MRI. And the radiologist had reported a high signal intensity in the proximal humerus and suggested a biopsy of that area. So my question is now we start with Sanjay Garude, your take.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, Sanjay.
Okay, so when you said about the range of movement, that is active was equal to his passive range of movement, right?
That is correct. And his power was good, normal.
So power was good, active, and there was a history of fall 4 years ago. There is a lytic area. I'm not sure what that etiology is. If there are no other systemic sign symptoms, overall the joint seems okay. Yes, I think there should be a biopsy, a CT-guided biopsy, probably, according to me, is something that I would want to consider here.
Okay. And the host surgeon, Sanjay, had called me for an arthroscopic release. So Should I go ahead and do the release, or I should say, no, we need to do a biopsy of that area?
Personally, I would have said we are dealing in a situation where we don't know the etiology. So therefore, providing symptomatic relief is not the way ahead. I would personally feel that we need to be sure of what that is. We can always schedule the arthroscopy at a later date once we know what we are dealing with.
Okay. So, Shashank, I can see you raising hand. Please, your take. As usual in our clinical discussion, short, crisp answers so that we can show more cases. Go ahead, Shashank. Shashank? Okay, yes. While Nilesh Kamath, since Shashank is off, he's there.
Yeah. Can we?
Shashank seems to be truly exhausted after the pre-meeting sessions. So we move on to Nilesh Kamath. Nilesh, where are you?
Am I audible?
Yes.
Very clear.
You are audible.
So can we go back to the plain X-ray if that's okay?
And then a lateral view. I was saying that. Can we see a lateral view?
So on the plain X-ray, so one thing which stands out is the proximal humerus does not look its normal contour. And if I were to be very critical about it, I can see a calcification or an altered shadow, which is there on the above the humeral head at the superior aspect. So although you have shown the coronal MRI and there is a history of trauma, so it would be imperative to see at least an axillary lateral or the axial cuts on the MRI before planning anything further.
Okay. So now is Shashank back?
Yes, I am back. That's exactly what I wanted to ask. I just wrote in the chat, I needed either axillary view or the axial cuts of the MRI. Yeah.
Okay. Now, Shashank.
Yeah. So this seems to be a deformed head, but the head seems to be inside the socket in this. Can I have some more slices in the axial cuts? Are there any more slices?
The slices are all in my mind. You can ask me.
So the head is located inside the joint.
But it is located, as you can see, there is no dislocation.
Yes, yeah. Yeah. And so it seems a deformed AVN head on this view, but it is inside the joint. Yes. Okay, that's fine. So
Shashank, can I stop you there? Why did you comment that there is AVN?
The shape is deformed. I think it's not the pure spherical shape of the humeral head, which I would expect to see in this cut.
Okay. So this surgeon has called me to do, a patient is admitted to do a frozen shoulder release. I have gone with both my bags and equipment. Not done many cases for a long time. So what should I do? Go ahead and do the release or?
No, I think here actually analysis is not complete. Here, in fact, the greater tuberosity perhaps.
Tuberosity.
And it has malunited posteriorly.
Absolutely, boys.
Your active is equal to your passive range of movement. That still does not explain this, you know. Because if he has got minus 10 degrees of external rotation, this situation for him to have become stiff in that position, it doesn't seem to really fit in very well. So here, definitely no release. First, if at all, you want to analyze that tuberosity and think of refixing that tuberosity in the correct position.
Okay. So that is quite right, Sanjay. And I guess Parag knows this case. So I will skip him if you don't mind, Parag.
No problem.
Yeah. Now, the clinical findings do fit. The passive external rotation is going to be blocked by that GT engaging with the glenoid margin posteriorly. So he is unlikely to get any passive or active external rotation. So the clinical findings fit. So of course, I did not do any arthroscopic release, as very rightly said by Sanjay and others. I did a tuberosity osteotomy and I fixed it. This was in late 90s. And the best part, let me share some experience and literature with all my friends, that when you have a late presentation like this, 4 years, whenever you do a corrective osteotomy, the results are guarded. So be careful in undertaking any corrective osteotomies of the tuberosity. 1950s, etc., with a late presentation of 4 years. But the best part of this Arab practice is there is no follow-up. So with this, the take-home message is that clinical examination is really the key to shoulder surgery, as I'm sure all my esteemed panelists will agree. And one must have an aggressive approach to fresh, greater tuberosity fracture. Even if it is slightly displaced, I tend to be aggressive in these situations because the results are not so good and the tuberosity will malunite and then you have a major problem. So with this summary, anybody wants to say anything else? All the five panelists, it's open. Raise your hand.
Can I ask a question, Dr. Desai?
Yes, please.
What was your approach for this? Which approach did you use to do this?
If
you
still remember, deltoid split.
Okay.
Yes, Sanjay.
I was just wondering that, you know, with the malunited fragment, with the rotation getting blocked passively, I can understand. But actively, the strength being equal in external rotation on both sides, it's a little difficult to understand because the infraspinatus is at an obvious mechanical disadvantage over here. So,
yes, Sanjay, but I hope you get the philosophy. The infraspinatus is...
I understand the scenario. I'm just trying to highlight the point for the sake of someone wanting to, you know, maybe if they encounter such a similar situation again.
Right. Okay. That point well taken. So any experts want to add anything to the conclusion or any dispute with the take-home message? Yes, Samantha.
The thing is that, Sanjay, you are telling that this is a four-year malunited GT fracture. So suppose your GT is, how the muscle is, suppose you have done the osteotomy and fix it with the whatever base position you thought of, how the muscles are going to act again if you increase the length? How about the muscle atrophy and fatigue, sir?
No, so whatever the condition of the infraspinatus or the muscles attached to the GT, we have to accept it. There's nothing that anybody can do anything about it. Your best chance of giving any possibility of improving this shoulder is to reconstitute the anatomy. You cannot go wrong in your approach if your attempt is to reconstitute the anatomy. Having said that, we accept that I already made a comment that the late presentation results of corrective osteotomy are guarded.
There is a question in the chat that is one screw with a washer good enough, or you added some anchors maybe?
No, this was IPS. This was in late, if I remember, it was 1999. But these days I don't use any screws. I use a double row technique that we all do in rotator cuff repair.
And the other question is, were you able to identify the place from where the bone had actually gone off? Because it says it's around 4 year old.
Yes, I could. I could carefully expose the malunited tuberosity. I could see where it is, and then with a guesstimate, I could osteotomize and bring it back.
Okay, perfect. I think
so, Sanjay. So your recommendation for the viewers is that never use the screw with the washer for this sort of fractures, even for the phrase of the world one.
Yes, I mean, I am reluctant to use metal, having experienced problems. And the reason is that most of these GT fractures, the cortex is like a little shell. It's like a biscuit. Mm-hmm. And you try to, the screw is an eyewash. It looks good on the X-ray. You feel happy on the X-ray. But you know that when you tighten the screw, it was not really holding well. And somehow shoulders do not like metal around them. So I tend to use a double row technique. It's an open technique for a larger piece, superior approach, pass one or two anchors medially into the raw fractured area, take it out of the cuff at the GT cuff junction, and either put a lateral row anchor, or if the GT fracture is extending too much distally, I put a screw as a post. So my lateral row is a screw with a washer.
So this is your recommendation both for the fresh and the old ones?
For the fresh. Old, like I said, is a guarded prognosis. So you should be aware that your results may not be what you expect.
Okay. So there is a question from Dr. Maheshwari. He says, any thought about going posterior approach considered that mobilization might be difficult from the front?
No, it is not difficult. I would rather do an approach which I do every day rather than try some uncommon approach. And we all have been doing all sorts of fracture fixations through the superior approach. We are all comfortable. We know that by rotating the arm, you can bring the posterior part of the head and GT into your vision, and there is no problem. So I would suggest that go for the superior deltoid split approach. Of course, we all will take care of the axillary nerve.
Dr. Rajneesh Garg asks that, what about transosseous fixation? Would you do a transosseous these days?
Transosseous.
So just making tunnels and then pulling the sutures out through the lateral cortex without any implant?
Sorry, I don't think I would do other than my usual double row technique.
Okay.
With the lateral row being either an anchor or a screw with washer.
Perfect. Satish Sonar wants to ask
IPS, a question.
Satish,
wait. IPS,
Shashank, IPS. Shashank, Satish Sonar is asking next question. Satish.
Sir, it's a stiff shoulder along with a malunited GT fracture. So would the deltopectoral approach would have been better so that you can release the capsule also and at the same time you can reposition the tuberosity?
So, number one, if you are comfortable with deltopectoral, there is no problem. You can do the deltopectoral approach and do the same operation. Number two, release the capsule. What capsule? I don't think I want to release any capsule in this case. And even if you do a deltopectoral approach, you will osteotomize the tuberosity by internally rotating the arm, bringing the tuberosity in your field of vision and osteotomizing. I don't think you will probably even enter the joint as much. So, let me share a little philosophical line. Surgery is an aid to nature. The minimum you do, the better the result. So I would not mess around with the capsule or anything. But deltopectoral approach, yes, you can happily use.
Shashank, you can ask. Shashank, you wanted to ask?
No, I was just answering that question regarding transosseous tunnels. This is one place I would not use a transosseous tunnel because of the GT fracture. The overlying cortex is gone. You will have a loose fixation. You cannot put the tuberosity back.
Okay. And a question comes from Dr. Mukesh Ladda. How did you osteotomize GT from head? Surgical tips, Dr. Sanjay, any surgical tip too?
Two tips. You need a sharp mind and a sharp osteotome.
Mukesh also asked how you mobilized. That Mukesh's question is how you mobilize the fragment with the soft tissue.
Chaps, the GT does not have, except for the bursal lining, there's nothing much. You take a periosteum elevator and a gauze piece and gently tease away all the soft tissues on the bone. It's nothing complicated or difficult. And then only catch is to guesstimate the approximate level of the greater tuberosity. And for that, if you want, you can take help of a C-arm.
Somebody is asking for a tuberosity plasty. I think your opinion. I think it is beyond that. Beyond that.
If I may just add, sir is trying to emphasize is that GT fracture should not be taken lightly. You need to go aggressive for fixation. Literature is not really clear on how long can you wait to mobilize the GT and fix it. It is seen that even after 4 to 6 weeks, if you try to go and fix that GT, it is always a struggle. But the important take home here is that GT fracture should not be taken in lightly. So am I right in saying that, sir?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay, perfect, sir. So we can go to the next case, sir. No more questions on the chat, sir.
Okay. So here is the next case. And again, interesting case. This was in early 2000, 42-year-old right-handed female, and had, this was referred to me in Jastok Hospital by the neurology department. And those who are familiar with the Jastok neurology department, it's a very high-powered department of Dr. Nosheer Wadia and gang. And they are very good. Unlike us, they spend 1 hour examining one patient, and they referred that the patient has a rotator cuff tear. So 42-year-old female, she has pain and weakness in the left shoulder since 1 year. Sorry, my screen is getting cut. No diabetes, trauma, we are not sure, no dislocation. And when I examine, you know, it's very difficult to challenge this neuro people. Supra was 5x5, but infra was really 2x5. And the subscap was normal, supra was normal. O'Brien was positive, relocation test was positive, impingement negative, and otherwise full range of movement. So I will start with Shashank. Shashank, what is your take? I'm not going to show you any images. Kya lagta hai aapko?
Yeah. So the first thing that comes to mind by this findings are a paralabral cyst compressing upon the branch of suprascapular nerve. By the findings, if I just go by your findings, what you have given here.
Okay. So Nilesh, Shashank is directly jumping into a spinoglenoid knot cyst. Aapko ye theek lagta hai kya? Khali ye supra infraspinatus tear hai mere hisab se to.
So for a 42-year-old lady, firstly, rotator cuff tear in the absence of a significant trauma, I wouldn't really put that as the first diagnosis because rotator cuffs don't fail so easily. Secondly, among shoulder surgeons, when we see this picture, yes, I would concur with what Shashank is saying that, yeah, probably if the same nerve is supplying the supraspinatus and infraspinatus, but supraspinatus is full strength, then I would think about a distal suprascapular neuropathy, the cause most likely a posterior labral tear with a paralabral cyst.
Okay. Samantha is raising his hand, if I can see.
My vote for suprascapular nerve problem, infraspinatus neuro.
Nerve problem, can you elaborate?
Because this is the nerve which is supplying the supra and infra, but the supra is spared, but the infra is gone.
So are you meaning a compression neuropathy or something else?
No, compression neuropathy from the paralabral cyst.
So you are same as others.
Posterior cyst.
Parag and Sanjay, anything different or you feel, is there a differential diagnosis in your mind?
Yes, I mean, I think in terms of the site of the lesion, yes, everyone, I agree that this, we have to look at the suprascapular nerve carefully. But I've seen two patients so far, similar age, one slightly older, where they had a neurofibroma or a primary nerve lesion of the suprascapular nerve. And one ended up going away. One was operated about 6 years now. And I would therefore, without seeing anything, non-dominant hand, 42-year female, I don't know how active she was or is, whether there's any real microtrauma here, whatever. I would not say for sure that this is a cyst, but this is to do with the suprascapular nerve. We've got to look at the nerve as well, not just assume that there is going to be a cyst.
Okay. Parag, you want to add or subtract anything?
No, I agree with the concur with the discussion so far. So it looks like a primary pathology involving the suprascapular nerve, but involving only the infraspinatus. So that means that, it's beyond the supraspinatus muscle itself. So all in all probability, it does look like suprascapular neuropathy at the level of the spinoglenoid notch.
Okay, so these are her plain x-rays and nothing really remarkable. And the neuro people have already done a EMG nerve conduction. That is one of their favorite tools. And this is what the report was, that compression of the nerve branch to infraspinatus. And this is the MRI picture. Now, so you have the axial cut and the Y cut as well as the superior labrum. Now, can you interpret this for me, Parag? Audience, how will you read and what all things you will look at?
So obviously the cyst is very obvious in the sort of the Y view as well as the axial cut. It is at the level of the spinoglenoid notch. I would usually look for a posterior superior labral tear as well, but from the given cuts, I'm not very sure of that. But in all probability, there is going to be a slap tear at the or a posterior superior labral tear, and which acts like a sort of a ball valve, lets the fluid come out, but not the other way around. So this does fit in the diagnosis of a spinoglenoid notch cyst. And in all probability, there would be a labral tear involved with it as well.
Okay. Now, Parag, just one comment on what you said. The coronal cut is showing the superior labrum detached, yes. Lower two images. But anyway, now my question to all the panelists is it right to think that a cyst means there is a labrum tear? In other words, have you come across situations where you have a cyst, but there is no labrum tear? Let's start from the top. I see Nilesh, and then I'll take one after the other. Nilesh, go ahead.
So most likely it has to be a cyst. But having said that, I have seen a huge intramuscular ganglion, which was underneath the or submuscular underneath the infraspinatus, which was compressing the nerve. So I would keep my differential open. I would not blindly say that if there is a cyst, that means there is a tear, although the likelihood is more.
So suppose, give me a figure, each panelist. Suppose you have seen 10 cysts. How many have a tear in your practice? Say you have seen 10 and 9 had a tear in the labrum.
I would say 9 would probably have a tear.
9, okay. Okay, Samantha?
I think 9 out of 10. It is mostly with the tears. I will take the tear first.
Sanjay, out of 10, how many are likely to have a labrum tear?
Yeah, almost all of them.
All of them. And Sashank, where are you?
Yes, I am here. I agree with them. Almost all. I haven't seen any of in my own practice anything else, but I have seen one of the YAPS cases showing an intramuscular tumor there, a tumor in the infraspinal fossa, giving this type of presentation. But yes, to your answer, almost all.
Okay, so sorry. So this was the arthroscopy finding. And look how the whole of superior labrum is lifting off along with the root of the biceps. So quite consistent with what we expect. Now my question to the panelist, starting with Parag, how many of you What's your treatment? How many of you will consider ultrasonic guided aspiration of the cyst versus open versus arthroscopy? Starting with Parag.
So it's a very, very interesting thing. For the last many cases now, we do that. We do ultrasound guided aspiration of the cyst in the OR itself and then go ahead and do a labral repair.
Okay. Let me ask Sanjay Garude. Sanjay, your take on how do you manage the cyst?
No, I would, during the arthroscopy, I would try and see if I can best drain the cyst intra-articularly, from the intra-articular side. But I would not go chasing it. And I have no personal experience with ultrasound-guided aspiration to give a long-term benefit of any kind. So I would perhaps not go in that direction.
So, Parag, I need to go back to you. How you must have witnessed the sonologist doing the job, or did you do the job?
So we do it ourselves, and we have the ultrasound machine, and we have a large bore 18 gauge spinal needle. Most of the times we are able to aspirate that the whole cyst, even including ones which have got septa in it. So we are quite happy with aspirating it. Gives us a nice gelatinous looking fluid that we can aspirate. There is no other advantage, but it just shortens the operative time because you don't have to actually go ahead and do anything to the cyst itself. Probably it's safer as well because of the fact that the nerve to the branch of the suprascapular nerve can be very close by to the cyst itself. And this has been our preferred approach for the past couple of years.
Okay.
So we just have to go in and do a labral repair straight away. Although the literature does suggest that even if you don't aspirate the cyst, if you just do a labral repair without going after the cyst, the results are pretty much the same.
Parag, if I try to be a little critical, when you are already there with a scope in the joint to do the slap repair, how much more time you're going to need to just suck out that cyst versus setting up a full ultrasound mechanism in place in the OR, that might take perhaps even more time.
No, actually it doesn't, because the setup is already there. And I think, as Dr. Garude said, sometimes you do have to go looking for it. And I think it would still be another 10 to 20 minutes.
So my question to the remaining panelists, how many would do an ultrasound guided aspiration of the cyst, like Parag said? Raise your hand.
Can I just add to this?
Yes, please, Parag.
So in some of our elderly patients above 70, we have even left them just doing an ultrasound guided aspiration and not doing anything to the shoulder joint. We have a 3-year follow-up of about 6 cases, and none of them have recurrence of the cyst or symptoms, just to add to the situation. Although we wouldn't do that in a younger patient, but in elderly with comorbidities, we have even done just aspiration, and they have been, we have a good series of them now, just okay. for information.
So that I will second that. That is why I was asking that how many have seen cyst without a labrum tear. So my experience is that if you have an elderly patient with a cyst, like Parag just said, then often these can be degenerative cysts. And these elderly cysts need not have any significant slap posterior superior labrum tear. And in these, you can attempt a treatment of the cyst in an isolated way, like Parag said. So can I presume that except Parag, nobody else would want to do an ultrasound guided aspiration of the cyst? All would do an arthroscopic sucking out of the cyst as well as repair of the labrum. IPS, any questions from the audience?
Satish is asking a question, sir. He has raised his hand. Satish, you can ask. Satish.
Sir, very recently I have seen a lady, 39-year-old, who is having isolated infraspinatus cyst without any labral tear. So in that case, I approach it through the subacromial space, just finding the scapular edge and just dissecting between the supraspinatus and infraspinatus. I identify the nerve and then decompress the cyst without damaging the labrum, and I have not done anything to the superior labrum. So there are cases where you can find the cyst without any labral tear, and you can approach it from the subacromial space also.
Okay, so that is an unusual presentation of Satish, where the patient was not that old and yet had a cyst without having a labrum tear. Any more questions, IPS? Before
two questions. Bhupesh is asking. Bhupesh is asking: is there a spontaneous healing which does happen that you may have labrum tear which has healed, but there is still a cyst there? Is it a possibility?
I think labrum tears unlikely to heal spontaneously. I have not seen too many labrum tears heal spontaneously, nor am I aware of any literature which says so. I doubt that, but. Okay. Once in a while, you can get a degenerative cyst even in a 39-year-old without a tear.
And he also asked, is there a role of a suprascapular nerve visualization when you're decompressing the cyst?
Not really, no.
Not.
Okay. Again, my philosophy is that do minimum surgery. Don't try to do too many things to that area. Do minimum and get out, yeah.
Okay, and the other question is, you just decompress the cyst or remove a part of bursa from the cyst wall as well by shaver?
No, see, you're not going to be, I'm going to show you my video, if
okay,
I may.
Perfect, I think we should then wait for your video and then we'll ask questions.
Yeah,
okay.
Unlikely to be able to see the cyst wall and all that. You'll just see a yellowish colored fluid come out.
Perfect.
So I'm just going to play the next slide.
I don't know, sir, I think there is.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I have evacuated the cyst through the tear, and I used two anchors, both posterior to the long head of biceps and one anchor in front of the biceps. So total 3 anchors I used because it was quite a large tear. Now, this is 4 months post-op, this patient, there was no pain. The infraspinatus power had come to normal. The shoulder function was normal. Just Spoke Hospital was kind to do a repeat MRI for no charge. And on the left, you see the top and bottom images are pre-op. On the right, image B and D are post-op. And you have a nice clear view of how the cyst is gone and the patient has recovered fully. So on the left, top and bottom images are pre-op. On the right, top and bottom images are post-op.
Sir, just a question before you proceed. Are you still using knotted anchors for your labrum repair? It's a big knot out there. So
yeah, yes. I am not a great fan of knotless anchors. I like to be in control of my repair. I don't like to depend on technology to control my repair.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So here is the anatomy for my younger colleagues, that how such a cyst can cause a compression neuropathy. It's a tight area over there in the notch area. And you can see that how close the glenoid is from where the nerve is exiting. So a cyst, which is say about 1.5 or 2 centimeters, can easily compress on that nerve. Just to give you an idea, initially when we did this case, this was in, as I said, early 2000, we were all very excited that what a case we've done. And then when we looked up the literature, there were series of 20 and 30 cases already. So our excitement was deflated. So take home message, when do I need an MRI in shoulder instability? Whenever you have or you suspect a soft tissue pathology, which is difficult to diagnose clinically, you need an MRI. So when you have a recurrent dislocation of shoulder, the diagnosis is not difficult, it is obvious, you may not need an MRI. But when you are suspecting a soft tissue problem, which is difficult to diagnose clinically, such as posterior instability, often the patient does not have a frank dislocation. It's just pain or subluxation. And you're not sure whether the subluxation is anterior or posterior. That happens. A slap tear, a cyst, or when you have complications like infection, you want to see the soft tissue damage around. So these are some of the indications when you, an MRI is really worth doing in a young question mark unstable shoulder.
Sir, question from Nagra Shetty before you go to next case. Is EMG important medico-legally, pre-operative and post-operative in these cases?
Post-operative and pre-op. You may do the pre-op EMG nerve conduction, but I always tell my patients that, look, I am going to take away the offending pressure on the nerve. Having done that, how much of that nerve will recover, I cannot predict. So there is, I would advise that have a disclaimer with the patient, because that is the reality. We have no control on how much the nerve will recover. So therefore, you may do a post-op EMG, but it's not in my hands. I will only decompress the nerve. How much it recovers, nature has to help.
IPS, can I ask one question?
Yeah, please.
Sir Sanjay sir and panelists, so many times when you see a posterior lateral tear, the MRI is inconclusive. So many times even when you have a panlabral tear too, we don't see the MRI showing the posterior lateral tear. Only when you do an arthroscopy, then you will find out that posterior lateral tear. So whenever you see an isolated cyst, many times that MRI may not show the lateral tear, posterior lateral tear. Is it so? I asked all the panelists who are seeing the cyst and doing decompression, how many cases they found, all the cases showed the posterior lateral tear in MRI.
So can I, IPS, can I summarize what the panelists said?
Yes, sir.
So, Sundar, I think almost most panelists agreed that 9 out of 10 times when you have a cyst, you will have a labrum tear.
Yes, sir.
That 9 out of 10 agreed. So that is a consensus there. Occasionally, you can get a cyst without a tear in the labrum. And by and large, this will be in the elderly patients because this could be a degenerative cyst like a ganglion on the wrist without trauma. So it could be, somebody, I think Satish or somebody mentioned of having a case with a cyst without a tear in a young patient. So that is an offbeat one, but this is the general philosophy. And we all are aware that MRI is not all that sensitive in picking up posterior superior labrum tears. Hence, the world has pushed arthro MRI. So that is a well-established fact, what you said, that MRI may not pick up a slap tear.
So the last question before we go ahead to the next case, Gaurav Sharma asks, clinically, was there an infraspinatus wasting which you were able to see? And also, was there an element of scapular dyskinesia in this case?
Scapular dyskinesia, I don't remember in this case. But yes, there was a weakness in the infraspinatus. There was some wasting, but nothing very obvious. But there was a frank weakness in the infraspinatus. No doubt about that.
And to the all panelists, on their experience, how long does this neuropathy take to recover? 3 weeks, 6 weeks, 12 weeks, roughly?
About more than 3 months in my case. It takes about 6 months or more.
Okay. Minimum is 3 months.
Yeah, they start improving. Clinically, the weakness starts going down, but complete recovery takes 6 months for sure.
Question to Dr. Sanjay. These patients do do tell that that dull aching pain has gone away. They also have a dull aching pain at the back of the shoulder. They have a relief of that pain, but the wasting takes a long time, long time.
Sir, one last question to Sanjay, sir.
Somebody is asking a question.
The degenerative cyst that you said, how do you tackle them, sir?
Acromial
root or between the labrum and bone or between the labrum and capsule? Where do you make a rent to tackle the degenerative cyst?
Okay, so first of all, if it is a degenerative cyst, I'm not too excited about a slap. That's my first attitude. And therefore, if the patient has failed conservative treatment, I will attempt with my sonologist an ultrasound guided aspiration of the cyst. And then warn the patient that if this doesn't work, only then will I operate. And if I end up operating, I will not go under the labrum. Like I do in a slap associated cyst. I expect that there will be no slap tear. I'll go above the labrum, like Satish mentioned, and go and evacuate the cyst through the capsule.
Okay, sir. I think that answers all the questions. So we go to the case number three, sir.
Okay, so case number three, we have a 48-year-old female. And you can see from the x-rays that there is some old fracture which has united. The trauma was 18 months ago. Okay, so now your take, starting with Shashank. Her complaint is a pain, a lot of pain, not improving, and some stiffness. Forward elevation is about 110, internal rotation to L1 and external rotation about 20 degrees. But pain is our main problem, interfering in day-to-day activities.
So she has, as you already mentioned, a malunited fracture. She has lost the head fulcrum in the joint, so her movements should be restricted. And
fulcrum? Sorry. What is head fulcrum?
So head, to have a good range of motion, you need to have a round congruous surface to hitch against the glenoid to have a good range of motion. So he should be the cause of the pain. So if your question is more specific, I can go ahead.
Shashank, can you have a simple English for that condition?
Well, avian secondary to malunion.
Yes. Thank you very much. So. Does everybody agree that this is a post-traumatic AVN?
And this is going to be acutely painful. So whatever I do for her, without replacing that part, I won't be able to provide pain relief.
So your treatment choice?
Of course, I would be imaging her further, but at the back of my mind, I'm thinking about some form of arthroplasty for her to alleviate her pain.
Can you be more specific, Nilesh? Can you be more specific? Your treatment, because short and crisp.
48, young patient. I would probably do a hemi for her, for the glenoid, or ream and run, depending on the imaging findings.
Okay. Do you expect anything wrong with the glenoid at this stage?
On x-rays, it's not looking that bad. That's why I said ream and run, sir.
No, but what do you expect? Do you expect anything majorly wrong with the glenoid at this stage?
No, at this stage, I don't, but eventually posterior.
So which type of hemi would you select?
I would do a platform-based hemi, sir.
Okay. Shashank. Just your treatment, short and crisp. Shashank is not there.
I agree with what Nilesh was telling. It has to be done with the hemi, if the glenoid looks good.
Okay, hemi, which type?
Platform-based, because if I don't do the platform-based, if I redo sometime, because my platform will do the trick.
Sanjay, can I?
Sir, Shashank is back.
Yes, Shashank, you're back.
So I will talk to this patient and explain her what her options are. And I will be, if the patient is ready to take a chance, I will tell her that there is a good chance that a simple arthroscopic debridement might do the trick. She might gain some 4 or 5 years with that surgery. I have seen patients' shoulders doing well with almost resolved head. I will go ahead, take a chance, and hopefully that will buy a few years to me. And then, of course, hemi is always an option.
Shashank, can you justify your treatment of arthroscopic debridement for an avascular necrosis grade 4 with any literature?
No, I can't recall any literature on that, but I've also seen many patients of avian of the humeral head which are having a reasonably good function without any pain in my practice.
That is fine. Avian not too symptomatic, but you said you will offer arthroscopic debridement. So I would like to know this novel treatment. You have any literature to back up?
No, as I said, no.
No, okay. No, no problem. Parag, do you agree with Sashank, an arthroscopic debridement? We are all presuming that the patient is refractory to conservative treatment.
So I think it's going to, if at all work, it's going to work for a very short time. I've had some experience, not with AVN, but young arthritics in whom we have done the so-called CAM procedure as popularized by Peter Millett, although this is a different entity. And vast majority of these avascular necrosis do not get enough pain relief by any other means. And for me, arthroscopic management, at least in my practice at my hands, is not an option.
Okay. Sanjay Garude. Sanjay, do you think, what is your take on arthroscopic debridement as a treatment for AVN?
Okay. So not really from the literature point of view, but purely from personal experience. If the cuff function seems reasonably okay, pain is overwhelming, then I would actually for sure consider an arthroscopy. I've done it on two occasions, and sometimes that subchondral area, that lysis that you see, that piece of humeral head cartilage is kind of floating in the joint. It tends to produce a lot of pain. We've removed that and done a simultaneous rotator interval release, not really a capsular release or anything of that kind. And anecdotally, but patients can get reasonable preservation of function with a very minimal procedure. And here, obviously, the key is telling the patient that you're not doing a curative procedure for them. But I do think that before heading to a hemi, which is an irreversible procedure, you can try a simpler procedure. I'm all for an arthroscopy.
Okay. How many of the panelists would want to do an arthroscopic debridement for this case? Samantha?
I am not going for the arthroscopic debridement because
Sanjay and Shashank only two are there.
IPS, your take, would you consider an arthroscopic debridement? Have you had any joy in AVN of shoulder?
No, sir. Never done it. So.
Okay. So,
it's Pratik here.
Sir, question.
What is your experience? Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
What is your experience? Because many of them are symptomatic, you know, when they come to you as 18 months. But if you wait for a little longer, most of the time they do tend to settle down. And even in young patient, you know, at this age, thinking of hemi, which we know has its own problems. So what is your experience? You know, waiting a little longer would also have helped in this patient?
Is that for me, Pratik?
Yes, for you.
Okay. So number one, not all AVNs become asymptomatic with time. That's not true. I have enough literature to back it. The best one is of Christian Gerber. Number two, I don't think arthroscopic debridement will be of much help in the long term. Most of our patients don't want to spend money and have a short-term relief. And 48 is an age when in this day and age of shoulder arthroplasty, this is what I did and this is what I continue to do. I have done a minimally invasive stemless hemiarthroplasty. The glenoid was quite virgin. I did not touch it. And the patient is now, I think, about 4 years, 3 or 4 years post-op, doing well and happy. Those who said would do a stemmed, of course you can do a stemmed prosthesis as well, but I think that when you have abnormal proximal humerus anatomy, it is much simpler, easier to do a stemless prosthesis if you have the know-how.
So sir, question is, even if she was a sickler, would you still have done the same?
A sickle cell?
Yes. So are you not afraid that if the sickling would, more collapse would happen in future, your prosthesis might become loose?
No, I don't think so.
Rather than this, okay.
So would the decision making here, when I'm talking about arthroscopy versus an arthroplasty option, I know that you're not in favor of arthroscopy and nor am I. But this subchondral collapse, the so-called crescent sign, if I may call it,
would
that take a lot of bearing on decision-making? Because this is, whatever we do on arthroscopy, this is not going to resolve the pain issues. So yes, for those who are... So for those who are offering arthroscopy, can they justify that excising this fragment, or how would we take care of this fragment on arthroscopy?
No, I would go one step further. I would not consider arthroscopy. This is a classic grade 4 FICAT AVN where there is a subchondral collapse and that crescent sign that you talked about. To me, there are only two options, leave alone versus an arthroplasty.
Right, sir.
Leave alone if the symptoms are not too much.
Sanjay?
Yes.
Sanjay, I've got a question for you. Suppose you do this stemless one. What is the advantage of not doing the platform one?
No, like I just mentioned, that I want to be minimally invasive. She's 48 years old. Imagine after 12, 13 years, even if I had to revise, it's so simple. I've just had to chop the proximal humerus at the level of the head, and I don't have to deal with the stem. I don't have to invade the stem unnecessarily. The pathology is in the proximal humerus. I'm only dealing with that. Why would I want to invade the canal? And also remember that your error in version, your error in doing a hemiarthroplasty, or
thing is that if you use the platforms here, your repeat becomes easy.
I missed that.
You're saying if you use a platform stem, then probably revision becomes easier because you're not going to do anything to the stem. That's what you're saying.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. So there is a recent paper on does platform behave like a platform, and the answer is no in the long run.
But you believed on that sometime just 2 years back.
Yes. But there are papers coming out. But having said that, the platform will not make it changing to any other prosthesis or a revision surgery, this will be as easy as any platform. But right now, by doing a platform, I'm invading the canal. I'm doing a bigger surgery.
So there is a question here. It was a post-traumatic lesion. So do you feel you would do an MRI to evaluate the cuff always in such
cases? Yes. It was done. MRI was done and the glenoid was okay and the cuff was normal.
Okay, perfect, sir.
So was it clinically.
Okay.
So do I proceed next or?
Yeah, sir. No more questions. You can proceed next, sir.
So this is a 31-year-old male. And some pain and a lot of stiffness, especially external rotation. And it's an old injury. What does it look like, Parag?
Looks like a very old locked posterior dislocation, sir.
Yes.
Locked posterior dislocation.
And it is a few years old. So now your treatment. Parag, since you said you picked the diagnosis, your treatment plan.
Sometimes, you know, some of these do come with an external rotation deficit as obviously there, but they do fairly decent in terms of range of motion. So I'd probably assess him clinically before taking a decision just on the imaging, because anything which is left out for 4 years, the head is obviously not viable. There are obvious changes on the glenoid as well. So dislocations which have been left along for such a long time, usually my idea is to leave them alone and just observe them. So for me...
Yes. But Parag, what a horrible looking x-ray, and he is a carpenter at a Bollywood superstar's house. Money is not a problem.
I think he should continue doing his carpentry, you know.
Okay. Who wants to do something to this?
There may be a fair chance that after I have done through, he may have to look for another job.
if he is happy with his carpentry, the superstar, then better leave him alone.
But Samantha, he has come to me, means he has some complaints.
Yes, definitely. But he had these complaints 4 years, it was much more.
So he has
complained. Because your progress will be guarded again. You don't never know whether he will be able to back to his carpentry or not.
Okay, let me rephrase my statement. He says that pain jada nahi hai, but I am functionally compromised. I want to improve my function, Dr. Desai. Can you please do it for me? and I don't want you. I want Dr. Sanjay Garude to treat me.
Okay. No, no I. No.
Then, you were asking for surgery. Then you were asking for surgery.
Sanjay, your take.
What are you trying to insinuate for Sanjay Garude?
Completely, completely agree. About here, this is not a situation where you want to operate at all. This is really a situation where, unless clinically we've not surgical procedure, you will necessarily make him better. And therefore, the best option would be to leave him alone for the time being, assuming that his function is reasonably okay.
So, Sanjay, if I can catch you, leave him alone for the time being.
Yes.
Because now he is 55 years old. So, ab kya aur mushkil ho jayega? It's the key, and do not be conned into thinking that I will be able to improve his function. So even now or later, pain will be the criteria to offer surgery. Anybody has disagreement with what Sanjay Garude said? Please raise your hand. Otherwise, I move one step further.
Pardon.
Everybody agrees. Pardon. Okay. So this is his function. It's amazing. You know, it's remarkable how shoulders and human beings adapt. Look at his, though I expect very poor external rotation, it's locked posteriorly, but still he's managed to adapt with his scapulothoracic movement to external rotation. He can put his hand behind the head. So, of course, we left him alone. With your kind permission, IPS, I move to the next case.
Sir, there is a question. How exactly to read an AP view on an X-ray not to miss a posterior dislocation? A very basic question, but just you can, I mean.
It's the light bulb sign. So,
complete overlap of the head and glenoid.
Correct.
Complete and 50% overlap.
But let me share something with my audience. Quote unquote, 70% of dislocation posteriorly are missed in the casualty in the United States of America. 70. So a high index of suspicion. Do not hesitate to order a CT scan. Agar thoda bhi doubt lage, but don't miss it. Otherwise, you end up with this kind of a patient. May I proceed further, IPS?
So, just a question. I mean, had you offered him surgery, was it an arthroplasty or was it a open reduction and fixation?
No. At 4 years, open reduction is out of question. If he had pain, as Sanjay Garude said, if he had pain just now, which is unbearable, he says, I'm not going to go out of this clinic without solving my pain, then I would offer between arthrodesis and arthroplasty, debate the two.
Okay, but so that's
arthrodesis will be on my cards.
Okay. So, sir, no more questions, sir. We can proceed to the next case.
Okay. So, this is a youngest chap. 38 years old. बचपन में लगा था साहब डोमिनेंट हैंड सो लेट अस स्टार्ट
दिक्कत क्या है दिक्कत क्या है सर
सब फंक्शनल मैं खुश नहीं हूं मैं बहुत कुछ नहीं कर पा रहा हूं फंक्शनल
लगा तो अभी तो दिक्कत क्या है
नहीं यार थोड़ा पेन भी है अभी लास्ट 2 साल से पेन थोड़ा बढ़ गया है और फंक्शनली आई एम नॉट हैप्पी इसमें कुछ आप मैंने सुना है कि आप तो कलकत्ता के नंबर वन हो किंग हो तो आप मेरे को हेल्प कर सकते हो
फंक्शन दिखाओ फंक्शन
मेरे को पूछो ना सब है फॉरवर्ड एलिवेशन इज अबाउट 90 इंटरनल रोटेशन इज टू सेक्रोइलियक जॉइंट एक्सटर्नल रोटेशन इज अबाउट 10 डिग्रीज
यस
विद सम पेन सामंता योर टेक
Yes, but still, if for the improvement of the function, probably I'm not going to touch him. Unless I have to at least counsel more rather than doing the surgery.
Okay, counsel me. I'm the patient.
Yes, because if you are bachpan mein laga tha, if you are 38, probably he has adjusted all his lifestyle with this sort of deformity. I think he should be happy with the movement. Even if I do surgery, I'm not going to improve much of his lifestyle.
It's almost 90 degree deformity. Parag, your take?
Still, the deltoid is probably is gone because the deltoid function will be real poor.
Deltoid is okay. 5x5. Parag, your take?
So, I mean, again, very difficult to say what was the initial offending situation, whether it was an injury, whether it was an infection.
No, injury. Like, it was an injury. There was no infection. No infection.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, again, to have an injury in a childhood with such a residual deformity is also very, very unusual because most of them would have significant amount of remodeling done, obviously, depending on the age. But again, assessing the neurology, making sure that there are no...
Neurology is normal. Neurology normal.
So again, this is an extreme case of what I would say a humerus varus, you know, as we see in a lot of kids with some kind of facial dysplasia. Again, with this amount of varus in for a long time, there is obviously a risk to the cartilage, which is what we have seen, that long-standing varus does lead to cartilage changes because of abnormal biomechanics. I think, again, assessing him clinically, looking at how his arm looks, and I may offer him an osteotomy.
Okay, can you just now elaborate on that osteotomy? Yes, what will you do and what do you expect to achieve?
Pardon me?
What will you do quickly in short? In osteotomy, and what do you expect to achieve?
That, we've done this in younger kids and adolescents for humerus varus. We do a lateral closing wedge osteotomy to improve upon the varus and improve the biomechanics of the shoulder. And we have very gratifying results for this. I would obviously, before operating, make sure that I have enough adequate imaging to even look at the retroversion. And while doing the osteotomy, we've even corrected that in quite a few many cases. So,
what was the average age of those patients that you operated?
Late teens.
So, 17, 18, 19, yeah.
Yes, or maybe very rarely early 20s.
Not at 38, right?
Not at 38. But as I said, one of the options to offer would be an osteotomy.
And what would convince you to accept surgery?
Patient's disability.
Okay. All right. Anybody agrees with Parag? Sashank, for you? You agree, disagree, number one?
I disagree. Again, this patient has managed for last 38 years, and that means he can do most of his work. At this age, chances of improving his function by correcting osteotomy are not much. At the maximum, I will be able to get about 10-20% improvement, and that's it. I don't know where the pain is coming from now. I get Parag's point that there might be some chondrolysis, but I'm not sure about that.
Okay, Nilesh Kamath.
Can I comment at this stage?
Yes, Parag, quickly.
Parag, you go on.
Yeah, I said long-standing varus leads to cartilage changes, and if this is the early beginning of cartilage issues, I certainly sincerely believe that changing the biomechanics can halt the further process of arthritis. So that would be one of the reasons for me to offer him surgery at this stage.
Okay. Nilesh?
Yeah, I don't think I would offer him anything. And if he's really insistent, I'll send him to Parag. I might worsen him than doing good to him.
Okay. So, IPS, any question or shall I?
No, sir. There is a question that if at all Parag is planning to do an osteotomy, would he do some amount of derotation so that he can bring a better part of the head in contact with glenoid? We are probably cartilage
exactly. I just made that point that I would look at the CT in all dimensions, and depending on that situation, I would add a derotation to that surgery. Yes.
Okay. So, perfect. Questions, sir. You proceed.
So, gentlemen, if you notice, this is case number 5A. And if you know me, that means there is a 5B coming. Now, this patient says, I have pain and I have some functional disability also. Forward elevation, more or less 90-100, internal rotation up to sacroiliac, external rotation 15 to 20 degrees, and I have pain. And the patient is how old?
45.
Yes. So now, Sashank.
Yeah.
Your take.
So this is a different. This is a different pathology totally. There, the restriction or pain is because of the high riding tuberosity. The pathology, the surgery, the prognosis is much better in this case. Getting the tuberosity back, or I don't think tuberoplasty will help in this. Getting the tuberosity back down there is a much easier and much has much better prognosis. I would operate on him if he had the same, almost the same thing Shashank, which you said about the last patient.
Shashank, let me stop you. Kya karoge aap?
MRI.
No. MRI mein the supraspinatus is intact, but it is thinned out. Quite thinned out. And infra and subscap are not bad. Supra is thinned out.
So in this patient, I will osteotomize the tuberosity and bring it down and reunite it just like the way you did it in your other case.
And the head?
I will not touch the head. I will not touch the head in this case, no.
So isolated distalization of tuberosity?
Yes.
Okay. Shashank, we discussed that when you can do a corrective osteotomy after late presentation, the results are guarded. You would still do it? You would expect, what will you tell the patient? Kya umeed rakhna hai? Main theek ho jaunga. Shashank is gone.
Patient ko batana padega. Aapko it is a guarded prognosis. It has to be extremely guarded prognosis. Extremely guarded.
Yeah, but is the extreme
for... I couldn't hear your question after the word guarded.
So, what will you tell the patient? What to expect? Mishra saab mein theek ho jaunga na?
So, your path, I can assure you can get a range of motion will be definitely better than that. I don't know if your strength, I will be able to improve your functional than the supraspinatus strength, but range of motion and pain will definitely get better with that surgery.
Okay, Nilesh Kamath, do you agree with what Shashank says? Will you do that? And if not, what will you do?
So I wouldn't do exactly the same thing that Shashank said, because I think the head is also into complete varus. So till I don't correct the varus, there's no question of functionality or range improving. So the difference between this case and the previous case, if I may add, is that the shaft was involved in the previous case. Whereas here, I can do a metaphyseal osteotomy, use a fibular strut graft and try to correct the varus. Prognosis is guarded, but still, I think I may be able to improve the function by doing a metaphyseal osteotomy and correcting both the varus and the tilting the tuberosity back with a strut graft.
Okay. Parag?
Yes, sir.
Your take. Now, first question is, will you do a isolated tuberosity corrective osteotomy?
No, I wouldn't do an isolated tuberosity osteotomy.
What will you do?
I probably do a double osteotomy here, like a lateral closing wedge osteotomy at the level of the upper metaphysis, and reassess at that stage. Sometimes correcting the varus, getting the head back in its original position, will push the tuberosity out beyond the acromion, and then reassess and see if I need to osteotomize a greater tuberosity and get it down as well. So I would also add perhaps an acromioplasty to that, because that would help me improve the exposure if I'm looking at dealing with the tuberosity as well. I would probably still do at the same time a tenotomy of the long head of the biceps. And I normally would shape my osteotomy from the bicipital groove further posteriorly.
Okay, so corrective osteotomy of the whole proximal humerus. Sanjay Garude.
Yeah, I don't have much personal experience in this situation, but I tend to agree with Parag that this and Nilesh that I think this, the fulcrum and the apex of the deformity is not just in the tuberosity. That's not the isolated. So if you do a lateral closing wedge, you're more likely to replicate anatomy. So that probably is the way ahead over here. But I don't have any personal experience in this degree of tuberosity correction.
Okay, any questions, IPS?
Sir, there is a question that acromion looks like astabilization happening. So would you work on the acromion as well, all the surgeons who are operating on this case?
Please, Parag and others, please answer.
I would intraoperatively assess that, and I would add an acromioplasty to improve the clearance at the level of the GT.
Okay.
Perfect.
And, even if you add on acromioplasty, this acromion is looking like acetabolization.
These are adaptive changes because of the long-standing duration, and obviously, once we plan to do a corrective surgery, this acromio-humeral distance can improve once. We do the corrective osteotomy. So as I said, a lot of this would be an intraoperative assessment as far as the GT is concerned. So I would start with a metaphyseal osteotomy and then deal with the GT once I have a proper assessment intra-op.
But here the distance is hardly 2 millimeter. You see?
Yes, but once you correct, if you look at the varus, this is almost 90 degrees. If you can get this to about 110 to 115, it might be a different ballgame altogether.
Sir, there is a question to Nilesh. You said that you will do some kind of fibular strut grafting as well. So if you can elaborate.
Right, sir. Effectively, when you're handling such kind of varus and those are delayed presentation, it's impossible to maintain that corrected position. It tends to collapse again. So what I would do, it's a limited experience, but I've done it for four cases where you take the fibular strut graft, you put it into the shaft and then backhammer it or try to bring it and hinge it against the tuberosity. So it's as if the tuberosity is sitting on a hat. And then when you're putting in a plate, the calcar screw goes through the shaft, through the strut graft and into the calcar region. So that tries to hold the varus.
So, but would you be opening the cuff from putting the fibula?
So you are, when you're doing the osteotomy, through the osteotomy you go in.
Okay, perfect.
So it's like a retrograde thing.
Yeah, we come back to Sanjay sir. Sir, what did you do and what is
the plan? I have injected the patient with depot and local anesthetic. He's 12 months since my injection. He's at the moment quite happy. And I am reluctant to touch this guy as of now. And when he comes back, I am going to debate in my mind between, I agree with what Parag said is what is on my mind, a corrective osteotomy. You can see the fracture healing line at the surgical neck level. Do a valgus corrective osteotomy. I think the distance between the acromion and the humerus is less, not because of anything else, but because of the varus.
Sanjay.
May I finish? And the other thing, on table, or otherwise also, I am keeping reverse as an option in this guy if he comes at a much later date. Instead of doing a corrective osteotomy, I may want to consider a reverse in this patient because I'm not sure how the cuff is going to function in this fellow after my corrective osteotomy. But I'm nervous. I'm not sure. So I have injected. He's happy at the moment. I have left him without surgery.
So in previous case, what did you do, sir?
Left him without surgery.
Sanjay, on a lighter mode.
Yes, please.
On a lighter mode, what is the harm I'm giving when he comes again? What is the harm in doing the second injection?
Yes, no harm. I love you. Okay, so take home message. Must know when not to operate. And this is my dialogue, which I love. Unlearning is a sign of maturity as a surgeon. You need to unlearn what you've learned. This was taught to me by my teacher, the great Dr. K.V. Chobal. I move to the next case. I can't see the age.
46, sir.
46. Yeah.
Right hand male pain stiffness.
Yeah. So as you can see, he's operated for instability, say, 15 years ago, pain and stiffness. So, IPS, can you throw some light? Aap kya karoge isko?
This is an arthritic shoulder, sir. Anchors probably might be proud and resulting in an arthritis of the shoulder. 46-year-old, pain and stiff now with such big osteophytes down. I don't think there is any role of arthroscopy surgery. If the patient is too much painful, probably we'll inject this patient and put him on a rehab plan and see how he behaves. Otherwise, then start counseling him for an arthroplasty.
Okay. Pratik, for you, anything else?
No, same. I would have initially asked for injection and conservative management. If not, obviously, we would like to see a CT scan and an investigation to see restore. Yeah, just to see how it is. So that shows quite bad glenoid as well as glenohumeral thing. So I would start thinking in terms of a replacement here.
Okay. Anybody disagrees, raise your hand. And IPS, please draw my attention. Who is raising hand?
Yeah, so no.
Or everybody agrees?
Yeah, everybody's agreeing. Nobody's raising the hand. Right.
So now my next question is, will you do a hemiarthroplasty or a total shoulder? Starting with Nilesh.
I think the glenoid is already worn out. You can see the irregular surface of the glenoid. There's an inferior osteophyte as well. I'll keep a total shoulder ready, but I'll assess on table. Less than 55 years of age, I would probably try doing a ream and run technique, although present papers are showing that it's worthwhile doing a total shoulder rather than a ream and run technique. But in my hands, I think in this case, to answer your question crisply, I would do a ream and run because he's 46, and I would do a hemi for him.
Those who will replace the glenoid, please. Parag, I know you will. Raise your hand. Yes. So Parag, you will replace the glenoid, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now does it worry you that in about 10, 12 years, this glenoid will become loose? He's 46.
Yes, it does worry me. But so I will still do a total.
Okay, now my question to you therefore is that Nilesh will do a hemi and get out. At 10 years, he may face a situation where there is erosion of the glenoid. But still the glenoid is virgin. And at 10 years, you will face a loose plastic glenoid.
I may face, sir. It's not confirmed that I am going to face.
No, it is. Forgive me, but it's confirmed. A data of more than 3,000 total shoulder, I will share with you, reported in 2019. There is a very, very high risk at 12 to 13 years. More than 50% of this glenoid will loosen, quote unquote, Pascal Beaulieu, multicenter study.
That's true, sir. But if you look at the same study, the total shoulders which were done were significantly earlier, and I think we have significantly better poly and we have significantly better instrument implants right now for me to be optimistic that this guy will touch 60 before I may have to revise him. At that stage, I'll probably do a reverse.
Okay. Now, so I think there is no dispute that the glenoid is at risk when you do it in a young patient of 46, that we agree, right?
And if I may add, those 10 years are going to be significantly better in terms of function as well as pain relief as compared to a hemi. Again, the same data from the same group of surgeons.
Okay. Now, but some pain may be there in a hemi, but my question to the panelists, all of them, is that are you more comfortable at 10, 12 years dealing with a loose bone cavitated glenoid versus a virgin glenoid of Nilesh Kamath when you had to do a revision surgery? Which is better and more comfortable for you? Let's start with the IPS. You tell who to start with.
You can start with Nilesh, sir, because Nilesh in addition is doing a ream and run, isn't it?
Yeah, but he's not replacing the glenoid.
I'm not replacing the glenoid. I'm keeping the glenoid.
Nilesh, IPS has given the ball in your court. Will you be happier dealing with a virgin glenoid, though it is a little eroded, versus a loose cavitated plastic glenoid which has come loose?
So whether I have to do a revision total or a revision reverse, it is a headache to manage that glenoid in the revision setting. So I'm happy with a virgin glenoid.
Okay. Next, who's there? Sashank.
I totally agree with Nilesh. I'm more comfortable dealing with a virgin glenoid. Yeah.
Okay, and we have Sanjay Garude, and of course.
So my take on this is that we may be happy dealing with a virgin glenoid in 10 or 12 years, but the point is, if the patient's going to get better symptomatic relief and a better function for those next 8, 10, 12 years, then he probably is looking for symptom resolution now. So just because we are scared and worried that we'll have a worse glenoid 12 years later, we should not compromise on the result that he's likely to get today. So I would keep the options of a total shoulder in mind rather than just ream and run.
Okay. So there we have a range of opinions between the two.
Sir, one opinion is coming from maybe Delhi. Nagra Shetty says, is there any role of arthroscopy and interpositional arthroplasty? He's 46.
Can I answer that?
Yeah, sir.
Okay, so a paper by Christian Gerber, he tried three different interposition arthroplasties. Synthetic patch versus fascia lata versus God knows what, all failed.
Okay, so I think Nagaraj gets the answer.
Can I add to that?
Yes.
So again, you know, I'm all in favor of total shoulder arthroplasty, but I would just like to add here that at the last ICSCS in Buenos Aires, Buzz Burkett had an eponymous lecture on this. And as a lot of us know, that Buzz is a big fan of hemiarthroplasties for arthritic shoulders. And he had shown phenomenal results with his form of interposition with various things, including allografts, etc. And he has shown some phenomenal results with such a treatment. So, I mean, in spite of the fact that given the current scenario, what is in my hands, I would still go for a total shoulder. But I mean, there is some literature which would suggest that doing a hemi with an interposition can give you a lasting solution in young patients.
Okay. If I can conclude IPS with my experience, I have been doing, as you probably all know, a hemi surface replacement in young arthritic shoulders. I have now more than 8 year follow-up of a surface replacement, which is a hemi. And I have had to revise only one out of those 70 odd cases, and this is 8 year follow-up. How much pain did these patients come back to me because of having done a hemi? Hardly any. Hardly any. So, therefore, hemi need not be ruled out. You can take a call on your own feeling and judgment. But my last question on this case is, how many of you still use metal anchors for pancart repair?
We don't use metal anchor anymore.
No metal anchors.
Nobody.
Okay. There is a question, sir. How would you rule out infection? This was already operated. There is a proud anchor. Are you sure that there is no infection before?
No infection. There is no.
How do you rule out infection? That's the question Dr. Bhasin asked.
Okay. So, does anybody on the panel want to take that?
I think from the MR, also from the blood picture, you can rule out infection because MRI is not.
MRI is showing synovitis. It is showing a lot of edema and uptake is there. So.
But still, it is not looking like an infection. It would have been infection, there would have been much more shadows.
Yeah.
This is an old surgery. If the patient was infected, it would have shown some signs of infection over the last 5 years, 10 years. I think he said 14 years back. Is that what you said, Dr. Desai?
More than that.
So if it was infection, there would have been much greater destruction. There would be some signs of infection, clinical,
biological, lab parameters. So all was normal.
Sanjay, there is a question for you. What is somebody is asking? What is ream and run? Just explain ream and run.
So Nilesh, you want to take
Nilesh
that?
Asked, yeah, Nilesh said ream and run.
So yeah. So what you need to do is so if you look at the axial cuts, you can see that the glenoid is definitely not congruous. So it is something which is a wavy looking glenoid. So you clear the glenoid of all the osteophytes and you do a labral release and simply use a reamer on a low torque mode and try to make it as congruous as possible. Do not take away the entire cartilage. That is what is ream and run.
Perfect. Okay. Satish is raising the hand. Satish, you can ask the last question and then we go to next case.
Can we just do a capsular release and osteoplasty of the humerus, remove those osteophytes, because most of the humeral head and glenoid looks normal. Because I have experience of two cases where because of the metal anchor, such things have happened. I removed those metal anchors, just do a capsular release and osteoplasty and patients are quite better symptomatically. Can we do this same in this case?
I think, Satish, you can do that, but the experience will be similar to what we experienced in osteoarthritis of the knee, where we used to remove all the osteophytes and do a synovectomy and debride and all. Your patient will benefit, but it will not be in the long term.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
One question. Last question. I think surface replacement. You talked about stemless. Is it like a hemi cap?
It's a cap. Yes, yeah. Hemi.
It's a cap. Okay, perfect.
But if I may add, sir, I think now all surface replacements are almost out. We don't get enough inventory. Whether it's the Copeland or the global cap, isn't it?
No, they are there. Cap is there.
Okay.
But very hard to get the Copeland one on that sort of thing. Very hard to get.
The Eclipse is still there, I think.
No, so the Eclipse is a stemless, so in which you actually chop off the head. Whereas so
in such cases, Copeland, are you putting stemless or a
hemi caps? They are resurfacing implants.
So that is likely to be. If I may share a meeting on shoulder arthroplasty, a webinar sometime on Saturday mostly, I'll let you know, which will cover all the topics.
Saturday is there. Sanjay, you are talking on total shoulder.
No, this is a different one I'm talking about. They are the top guys in their field on each of those implants. So can I move to the next?
This
is Pratik here. Can I ask one question, please?
Yes, Pratik.
Yeah, Sanjay, you had asked about metallic anchor. I just wanted to take an opinion of all the house.
is everybody not using at all any metallic anchors? Because we still, on occasions when we have economical consideration, do use some time. So, but what's the opinion of panelists? Are none of us
for, using... for instability is a big no. For instability, it is a big no.
What same, no, same here. No metal anchors in the glenoid.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good. Okay. So, sir, take home messages.
You saw that Bankart repair, what a mess it created. And the slide case 5A and 5B when not to operate. So we also must know how to operate and not create complications and problems. This is the take-home message of this case number 6. And we end, we have another 7 minutes left, IPS.
Yeah, sir, 7 minutes left.
Around so I'm on the dot. We have this, he's a software techie who presented to me 20 months following this injury. And as you can see on the MRI, he's 29 years old. And guess what? It was missed in the United States, New York.
It is a more or less looking like a posterior sort of thing.
Is it posterior?
It looks. So do you have more cuts?
More cuts, yeah.
No, unfortunately,
like locked anterior dislocation. That's what I thought. But
yes, quite right. It's a locked anterior dislocation. And as you can imagine, there is hardly any range of movement. He's 20 months down the line and the glenoid is almost crushed.
Yes.
So he's complaining of poor function, some pain, but poor function. So starting with Nilesh.
So at 20 months, locked anterior dislocation, usually these are really well tolerated. I'm definitely not going to intervene here. I'm just going to put him on rehab and let him try to compensate as much as possible.
Okay, Samantha.
Yes, 20 months, it is very difficult, very difficult.
Okay, Sanjay.
Yeah, we should really check out his cartilage, what's happening here. A little bit more investigations, for sure we need more images, but 20 months is not an easy time to try and put a humeralid back into the glenoid.
Yeah. Nilesh?
Yeah, I said so, sir. I'm not going to intervene. Locked anterior dislocation is well tolerated. We'll conserve this, rehab him.
Okay, so that's what we did didn't touch him at all. And with this last slide, I thank all my expert panelists. I thank IAS and IPS and Samantha for a wonderful session. I enjoyed it and learned as much as you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir. It was a wonderful meeting here.
Thank you.
Thank you, entire faculty, and thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yes, Samantha.
Yes, thank you, Sanjay, for your nice cases. This is really too good. We learned a lot from, and I am really thankful for all the faculties. Because Nilesh, then everybody, Parag, Sanjay, you people are really too good. We have learned many things. I think all the viewers, those who are listening to this IES program, they are also loving this program. So I think IPS, you can give 2-3 take-home points for the viewers.
No, I think young injured shoulders should not be neglected. There are cases where you might end up doing surgery which might help the patient, but then there are cases where it should not be touched. We do have a next webinar, which is tomorrow, and we have none other than Buddy Savoy, which is there, leading shoulder guy. We start at 7 p.m. tomorrow, and 7:30 p.m. tomorrow, because of the time difference, that is how it is doing. He's going to talk on massive rotator cuff tears, and it's a master class wholly and solely run by Buddy, and I think it's not to be missed, master class tomorrow at 7:30. Thank you very much, and thank you, entire faculty, for being here.
Thank you, Sanjay. Thank you.